Welcome to another inspiring message from Victory Church. We believe that God is at work right now to bring victory to your life. For more information about Victory Church, find us online at www.victorychurchnwa.com.
You touch all of us that are in this room, some of our church family who are not able to be here today, God. Lay your hand upon Judy Day in the hospital. Touch her now, God. Touch her little body. Raise her up in the name of the Lord. Mark and Rhonda, God, keep them safe and in your care. Lay your hand upon them. And give them a speedy recovery, God, from COVID. I ask God today, lots and lots of others that I do not know about, or my mind slips me up. God, it doesn't slip your mind. You know us, and you know our needs, and you know who we are. And today, God, I ask you to touch our people. Lay your hand upon them. Those who are watching by means of the internet today, God, some of our family from years past, God, that are watching today, I ask you to touch them. Let them know that they're not by themselves, that you love them and you care for them, and your hand is upon their lives. Now, God, in this room today, every person that's here, God, I ask you to challenge our hearts to become the person that gives their life to you. Because our lives are not our own. They're yours. And we give ourselves to you today in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Turn around, hug a neck, shake a hand, give a fist bump, a high five, whatever. Just let people know you're glad they're in the house today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise your name. Jesus, you're the center of my joy. All that's good and perfect comes from you. You're the height of my contentment, the hope for all I do. Jesus, you're the center of my joy. Yes. Oh, Jesus, you're the center of my joy. Center of my joy. Sing it. And oh, Jesus, you're the center of my joy. Hope do. Jesus, you're the center of my joy. Hallelujah. 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 You may be seated if you'd like. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's definitely be in prayer on many fronts today. I think internationally, our world is in a bad shape. And we need God more now than we've ever needed God. The only thing that will get us through the chaos that's going on in our world today is the help of God Almighty. Our nation needs prayer. We've got to believe God for God to touch our nation. The next several months or several, let me put, are critical to what happens in our nation. And I pray that everyone votes that can. And I pray that you pray before you vote. That you don't vote just some goofy thing off the wall, but you vote and allow the Holy Spirit to lead you in your godly convictions, not in your selfish motives. Was I preaching right then or not? And we got to pray for our nation. We got to pray for our church. Our church. Right now, we are in the process of finalizing all the different engineering things that has to be done on a new building. I remember when we built buildings and we just built buildings. And now, all of a sudden, you've got to explain every detail of everything that you're doing and have to pay someone to do that. And then after they do all that, then you build a building like you want to. How crazy it is, the world that we're in today with all of it. And it costs a lot of money, just the engineering stage, before we ever start a building. So we've got to have God's help, God's blessing upon us, and God's favor upon us as we get ready to go into a monumental building process for us here at the church. One bigger than anything that we've done now in a lot of years, tons of years. But the same God that gave us miracles before is the God that will give us miracles now. Having said amen, there's no doubt about it. I'm going to talk to you about something this morning that kind of hinges off of what we talked about last week and we've been talking about for a while. But when God looks at you, what does he see? We're his children. We're his creation. And the big thing, let me ask you this. Have you ever thought, am I pleasing to God? How profitable am I to the kingdom? I tell young people all the time this. I said, if you want to have longevity on a job, make yourself indispensable. You understand what I'm saying? In other words, they need you so bad that they can't afford for you to be gone. And you know what that really boils down to? Is you become profitable to your employer. That kind of thing is maybe not necessarily something that's given in our world today. One of our people in the church who's involved kind of in an administrative role said in her particular role that every day she has employees that come to her and their question is when do I get to go home? I wanted to, you know, kind of kick people in the shins when they do this, but they talk about ministers and pastors. Said, you don't do anything. You know, I've never, well, I say never, that's too big of a statement. Many years ago, this changed for me. Don't call me Reverend, because I'm not. Reverend be his name. He's the only one's Reverend, not me. But the big thing with that REV for Reverend, the way they shorten it, guys came up with this deal. What it really means is we just rest, eat, and visit. Yeah, they do. I tell people quite often, they say, you don't do anything, do you? And I said, just follow me. And most people can't. I keep telling God, you know, when you get into this seventh decade, should you be able to slow down a little bit? And I plan on it someday. And probably the only time that'll happen is when God takes me home. And because there's still too much to get done, so much work, so much to be accomplished. But one of the things that I want God to know, or God to say about me, is I have been a faithful, profitable servant. You know what profit is? I heard a story some years ago, and this is so true, especially of our world. Two guys decided they was going to buy them a truck and they was going to go pick up watermelons and sell them and make their living selling watermelons. So what they did, they bought this big truck, they filled it up with watermelons, they paid $1 for the watermelons, and they decided what we're going to do is we're going to sell them for $2, we'll make $1 profit. And we'll, you know, everything's going to be good. So they went out the side of the road, and they was trying to sell watermelons for $2, and nobody would buy them. So they went down to $1.50, and they sold one or two, but they wasn't selling anything of significance. So finally one day they said, you know, we got to get rid of these watermelons. And so they put a big sign out that says, watermelons, $1. They sold out immediately. They got to looking at everything and they said, we didn't make any money. What are we going to do? And the other one looked at him and said, I got a good idea. Let's buy another truck. Did you get that? Some of you on the way home will say, oh, that's what he meant. You can't make a profit, even if you sell volume, if you're not making a profit on one, you sure won't make it on 100. Profit is this. Profit is when you buy something for a price and you sell it for more than what you paid for. Most of us go through our lives, and that isn't necessarily the case. Most of us go through our lives, and the things that we buy, within a few days after we bought them, they're worth half what we paid for them. You know who made the profit? The one who sold it to you. That's the way it is. But you see, God wants you to be profitable. Amen. God wants you to be profitable in your life. Now, let me take you back to what we talked about in the last few Sundays. Genesis chapter 2. The Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and he became a what? A living being, a living soul. The Lord planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Let me say this to you. God has a place for you. Every person in this room, God has a place for you. Let me take that a little bit further. There are several places that each one of those are strategic to you in your life. First, it's the place that you live. Where you live. That is your Eden. The place that you live. That Eden that's there, God gave it to you to tend it and take care of it when you go down a few more verses in the verses of Scripture that I gave you. I look at some people's homes and I see them as not tending and caring very well. I didn't have to say that, did I? But it's the truth. Is it a God principle to take care of what you have? Absolutely. It's what makes us profitable when we take care of what we have. So we have a place, the place that we live. It becomes our garden there that God wants us to tend and take care of. Then we have a workplace. The workplace that you're in, God put you in that workplace for a purpose. Can I tell you that God doesn't necessarily, and this doesn't cost you any extra this morning when I say what I'm getting ready to say. God doesn't change his mind about your workplace every other week just to fit your fancy. It's learning how to stick with it in the workplace. Tend it. Take care of it well. When you get to that place, then you become the indispensable person in that spot, in the workplace, so profitable to the person that or the company that you're working for that they cannot afford to be without you. So it's a place. Now, let me take you to another place. That's the place that you worship. That's the place that we gather together. It's the place of fellowship. It's the place of what the Bible talks about from the Greek. It was called koinonia. It's this place of fellowship where people get together. Now, let me say something. You can serve God without anybody else being involved in it. I'm telling you, you can't. But you're not going to serve God as well, and you're not going to be as profitable when you're trying to do it by yourself. There is something about this not neglecting the assembling of ourselves together that's quite important in our lives. We need each other. There is a synergistic thing that happens to us in our lives when we have one another. Now, I understand that there are a lot of people today that are thinking they can make it as well by watching either on YouTube, Facebook Live, or some other source on the internet and think that that's good enough. But can I tell you, there's going to be moments. Well, let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. I have people that get on Facebook and they listen to a program, they do this, that, and the other. And then they want to message me on Facebook and have me pray for them. You know what usually happens with that? I finally get around to going to Messenger about once every 3 weeks. So you're already past your time of need, and it's my fault? No. I tell you, I don't like it. I don't go there. It's not my world. So don't blame me because I didn't pray for you immediately on the spot. There is something about being in the house, having that relationship with one another. And what I love about the koinonia of this church is the fact that people are developing these relationships between each other, and I'm not in the mix. They just pray for one another. They just help one another. And it makes my job a whole lot easier. You understand what I'm saying? There's something about this, developing this relationship with one another that's quite important in what goes on. So we have the place of worship. And that place of worship becomes a part of how we become successful in the kingdom of God. Can I tell you something else about this? We have had indoctrinated, I guess is a good way of putting it, indoctrinated to large campaigns where people by the hundreds get saved in a stadium or in an auditorium. And while all of that is quite good and it's wonderful that people get saved there like that. At the very same time, it is very concerning to me as a pastor that babies are being born and left in the auditorium or in the stadium and have no one to nurture them, feed them, prepare them for their future. Are you with me? You see, it's one thing to do that and say, oh, we had hundreds saved. Where are they at? You're leaving them at the point of birthplace with no one there to take care of them, and we think that's okay? No, every baby born in this house needs somebody to be there to give them their bottle, to help them with their growth. If you please, change their diaper. Are you with me? You understand where I'm going with this. You see, when God puts us in a place, when he does it, he puts us there to tend it and to keep it. That is verse number 14 of Genesis 2. 15. Don't have my glasses on. The Lord took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to tend it and to keep it. Your garden, at your home, in the workplace, in your place of worship, and then just in your general point of life, your place. You're going to develop relationships with people that I'm not going to develop the relationship with at the time. Now, before it's over with, I hope I get to know about those relationships. You know, I get to thinking back to, goodness, not much more than 6 months ago when Brother George was coming to me and said, Pastor, I just really don't know what God wants me to do with my life, and I'm so upset about it. Wasn't you? And then all of a sudden, God started doing some things, and God started putting men in his life that are sitting here in this room today. I call that a profitable servant. Are you with me? He's not just talking about it. He's sharing it to the place now that these men, you know, I have to tell you, I really don't even know their real names, but I know who Dutch is, and I know who Smoke is, and I know who Bones is. And then I found out that Brother George's Cosmos. Woo! He's zooming around. You're out there. But what we do is we bring our place to the place. Do you understand what I'm saying? Is that okay? What makes us profitable is the fact that we're not sitting around just saying something's going to happen, but we're making things happen with what we do. You see, what we've done is we have developed this deal. We have two particular persuasions. One is we're willing to do a four-letter word. Don't everybody go, oh, what's that? You probably will. It's W-O-R-K. We don't want to work. We just want God to just bring it all to us. And I hear preachers say and people say things like this. We just go to the church and we pray and say, God, bring them all into the church. Fill the church. And my crazy mind, which is very different than most, when I hear people say that, I'm saying, okay, God, what are you going to do? Is God going to grab them by the collar and say,
You didn't have anybody tell you about this church where, come on, I'm getting you there. Does God do that? No, he doesn't do anything like that. You know what God does? God uses us. It isn't depending upon the Holy Spirit to get them here. God is depending upon you to be led by the Holy Spirit, and wherever, whatever place you're in, whether it's in your just your personal world, it's in your home area, in your neighborhood, it's in the workplace or in the fellowship place, wherever you are, God wants you to be developing relationships that are profitable. Profitable. I wrote something down in my notes today that I just thought you might get a kick out of. Everyone's willing. Some are willing to do the work, and others are willing to let you do the work. I heard a story several years ago by a man that built a huge church in the Lubbock, Texas area. When he went there, church was small. They didn't have a lot of money. And so it meant, and to think of this particular guy as a person that was out doing this, because he wasn't necessarily blue collar at all. He was very white collar in most of his ways. But Dr. Morris Sheets said, he said, I was out taking a shovel, digging footings for a church. And I'm thinking, man, that's a long time ago to go back that far and have to do it that way. But he said, that's what I was doing. And he said, this guy walks up to me. I'm down in the ditch, and I'm trying to clean out the ditch, getting ready to pour footings. And the guy said to me, he said, preacher, you think you're ever going to get it done? He said, yes, I'm going to get it done. You grab that shovel and help me. We'll get it done quicker. You understand what I'm saying? Don't just be willing to let somebody do all the work, but be willing to be a part of the profitable side of what it takes to get something done in the kingdom of God. So from that, let me read you a scripture. Matthew chapter 25. Do I have any glasses over there? I don't know if I brought them in or not. For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling into a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each one according to his own ability, and immediately he went on a journey. And then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 more also, and he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money. And after a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. Let me stop for a second and just say this to you. That this, thank you so much. That Lord that gave the 5, the 2, and the 1, the one who did that, he didn't tell them how to do what they did. He didn't. He didn't say, now, here's what I want you to do. I want you to take your 5 and go invest it in the stock market, in this particular stock, because it's really going right now. Put it in that particular stock, because when I get back, if you do that, you're going to double your money. He didn't do that. He didn't say, this is what you do. Take that and go buy watermelons. He didn't do that. Nothing like that happened with what went on. He just gave them, it says in the scripture, according to their talents. In other words, he knew that he couldn't trust that guy that he gave the 1 to there was no need to give him five because he wasn't going to do any more with five than he would with one. So why give him more? So he gave him only one talent, and he expected out of that talent for something to happen. When I start looking at all of this and I start thinking about it, you see, there are times that God's not going to give you the total plan. He's not going to set out the total blueprint of what you're to do. There are times when God just expects you to be creative on your own. You say, my excuse is that God didn't tell me what to do. Well, here's what you do. Whatever your hands find to do, what? Do it. Do it with all your mind. There will be times when God puts the opportunity in front of you to be a blessing to somebody, and when he does, you're going to say, I don't like that plan. That isn't the person that I want to go to. That's not the person I want to become involved with. But you see, when your hands find to do it, just do it. Become profitable in whatever place that you're in. So what happens is the master comes back, the ruler comes back, and when he gets back, this is what happened. So he who had received five talents came, brought five other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered me five talents. Look, I've gained five more besides them. And he said to him, well done, good and faithful servant, for you've been faithful over a few things. I will make you what? Ruler. Ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Now, when you start reading this, what you find out is what's actually happening out of this. This isn't talking about just an earthly setting from the standpoint of a guy going off and doing things and he left his valuables to people. What's actually happening, this is God's work, and what you're doing is God is putting talents in your life. What are you doing with the talents that God's given to you? And the day will come when God will return. I know that there are people that are saying he's not going to, but he better get here quick. Are you with me? When he returns, now let me say something else. He may return for you. It may not necessarily be this big corporate return. For you, it may be a single thing that God returns for you. And you're going to come to the time in your life where you draw your last breath. And when you have drawn your last breath and you stand before God, what's going to happen with you? Is God going to say, well done, you took the five that I gave you, gained me five more, entered into the joy of the Lord, I'm making you ruler. I want to be a ruler. I don't know about you. I've already made up my mind, you know, when it talks about the new heavens and the new earth and how that God is going to restore and rejuvenate this earth, I'm going to get off the subject for a second, but it's okay. Can I tell you something? This earth is going to last as long as God needs it to. And some people are calling what they're doing is tending and taking care of it, and all they're doing is causing problems. Can I tell you that this earth's going to be here as long as God needs it to, and when it comes to place that it won't work anymore, God's going to give us a new heaven and a new earth. He's going to restore this earth. He's going to recreate this earth. I really believe this, that when he does all that, he's not necessarily going to destroy everything like he did before. All he's going to do is he's just going to make it better. But when he makes it better, the places that we have are still going to be here, and we're going to get to come back to where we were. And I'm going to get to rule where I'm at. So Victory and Eagle Crest, you may get rid of me for a few days, but you're not going to get rid of me forever. I'm coming back. I'm coming back with him on a white horse. Hallelujah. Why? Because I believe that God is going to say to me, I've been faithful. Now, I may not have been the best in the world, and I may not have had the biggest in the world, but I've been faithful. How about you? I think you have. I look at people in this room, that's the kind of people that we are in this church. So, next. Get back to where I need to go. So, next. He also who had received 2 talents, verse 22, came and said, Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents. Look, I've gained 2 more talents besides them. And he said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I'll make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Now, same thing, same word said. Then he who had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew that you were a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. And the Lord answered and said, you wicked and... I don't like that 4-letter word. Lazy servant. You knew that I reap where I've not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming I would have received back my own with interest. Therefore, take the talent from him, give it to him who has the 10 talents, for to everyone who has, more will be given, and he will have abundance, and from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. And cast out the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Okay, let's take it one more step. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. The Apostle Paul is having problems with people wondering about his credibility. So what happens in the middle of this, he writes to the Corinthian church and he says, do we begin again to commend ourselves? Or do we need, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation, or actually it would be, in our terms today, recommendation from you? You are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read by all men. In other words, he said, this is what I have to say to you. You're the result of what God has done for you in your lives through our teaching, through our training, through our help, is our letter of recommendation. The letter of recommendation is not something that's penned with words on a page. They are fruits of our labor. You understand what I'm saying? So, he says, clearly you're an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, not on tables of stone, but on the tables of flesh, that is the heart. And we have such trust through Christ toward God. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as being from ourselves. Our sufficiency is from God. You see, God never gives you a project that he doesn't equip you to fulfill the project he's given to you. Don't ever say, I can't do it, if God told you to do it. Because you see, the God that I serve, the God that I know, He is not going to give me a project that at the end of the whole thing that I am ultimately going to fail. He prepares me. Chapter 4 of 2 Corinthians. Therefore, since we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart. Now, I'm going to tell you, there are times, quite often, sometimes several times a week, that in the middle of the stress of what has to be done to get something done, you want to give up. It could become easy to lose heart. I think the church world is full of ADHD people. And I really don't know what that ADHD stands for, other than the fact that people start out doing things and then the next thing they do is they're doing something else. They can't keep their attention on the same thing very long. You know people like that? One day God said for me to go do so and so. I'm going, oh, no, God said, go this way. Oh, God said, go this way. Oh, I don't think God's that crazy. You may be, but I don't think God is. I don't think God's in the business of moving us around, taking us all these different places, doing all this junk in our lives. I don't think that's who God is. I believe that God gives us a task, and when He gives us that task, He makes us sufficient to do it. Amen? Therefore, we have received this ministry as we receive mercy. We do not lose heart. There are times we would like to give up on the project, and we would like to have the excuse that God told me to do something else, when really it was none of that particular thing. You were just being pressured by the devil. If I wanted to have a pity party, I could tell you about my day yesterday. Because I had a day yesterday that most people would say was the day from hell. Everything that could go wrong seemed to be going wrong yesterday in that day. It would have been real easy to have said, somebody else get up and preach today. But I am here because I don't lose heart. I am here because I understand that regardless of what I am experiencing in that particular day, it does not mean that God wants me to stop. What God wants me to do is continue on. He's given me some talents, and until He gets back, I'm going to do everything I possibly can with those talents. And I believe at the ultimate end of the whole thing, when He gets back, there's going to be some profit. Some profit. Now, I could get real heavy in this next part. I'm not going to. We've renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness or handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the fear of God, in the sight of God. But even if a gospel is veiled, it's veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. We do not preach ourselves, but Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. Powerful words. For it is God who commanded the light to shine out of the darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We have this treasure where? In earthen vessels. That the excellence is of the power of the power of God may be of God and not of us. It's not to get your own glory. It's not about you. It's not about you. Several years ago, there was a couple that came to Northwest Arkansas to go to school. The girl was going to school to the University of Arkansas in their law department. She became an attorney. They were so poor when they got here, they didn't have a lot. And so most every Sunday during the time that she was in law school, on Sundays we took them with us wherever we went to eat and we fed them. At least we knew they got one meal a week. So when the degree was granted, she passed the bar. She came to me and she said, "Pastor, I want to do something for you." She said, "I want to help you get your own personal 501c3 for ministry. I think you need that." So she did all of it. I didn't do anything. I didn't have anything to do with naming it or anything else. So she got it all finished up and she came and presented it to me as a gift. And this was what its name was Billy Kaufman Ministries, Inc. And while I loved the gift, I disdained the name because I don't want my name on anything. It's not about me, and it's not about who I am. Now, I know that other preachers think it's okay to do it. I'm not trying to say that they're wrong. I don't, because you see, I'm an earthen vessel, and this earthen vessel, for it to be of God, God's got to be at the forefront, not me. Are you with me? We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency will be of God and not of us. Next verse. This is the hard part. This is something every one of us deal with. We're hard pressed on every side. I'm just going to read the first part of some things and then we'll come back to the other part. We're hard pressed on every side. We are perplexed. We're persecuted. Let's read it now in completeness. We're hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. We're perplexed, but not in despair. We're persecuted, but not forsaken. We're struck down, but we're not destroyed. Do you hear that? Now, I know that doesn't make you want everyone to take your resume and your application and put it in front of everybody else when you hear those particular things. But you see, in the kingdom of God, you have to understand we have an adversary that's trying to stop everything we personally do. So, when he does all this, we're hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. We're perplexed. Have you ever been there? Maybe you're there right now. but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Christ may be manifested in you. Verse 16. Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. For while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So, in the process of all of this, and I'm closing, John 15, Jesus said, I'm the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. And every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, that it may bear what? More fruit. So in other words, I start bearing fruit, and God says, that's good. So let me clip a little bit of this away. Oh. It starts clipping stuff off. Over here. Let me clip this. Oh. That's me that's saying the oh. Because God just pruned some things off of me. Have you had God prune you? There's some things God has to prune away to get us to the place that we do what? We bear more fruit. So, verse 3. You're already clean because of the word which I've spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I'm the vine, you're the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. And then he says this, for without me, you can do nothing. Where's my sufficiency? I just read it to you a moment ago. It's in God. You say, well, I've just trained so well, Pastor. I just know everything. Oh, no, you don't. Because the very moment you think you know it all, God takes you back to school one more time. So, if anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they're burned. But if you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. Last thing, verse 8. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. So will you be my disciples. Amen. Hallelujah. How many in the room want to be profitable for God? How many want, when your last breath is drawn and you stand before your Maker, for him to be there with a smile on his face saying, I'm proud of you. You were a faithful servant. That's me. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you that sometimes I get so intense with this whole thing that some people don't understand who I am and why I'm the way I am. I am probably the most different guy that you'll ever meet because my life has been consumed now, 58 years I've been saved. At least 58 years since I was saved the last time. Soon, in January, right before January 1st, it will be 58 years that I've been preaching the gospel. I'm going to tell you that my beginning days of preaching the gospel was laughable. My pastor said about me, he said, "You know, you get things out of the scripture I never saw." And I thought he was paying me a compliment. But that's the way I started. And I think people probably still think the same thing today. They just don't say it. But I love it. I love what happened with Jesus. He gets baptized in the River Jordan. And when he come up out of the water, heavens open up. Holy Spirit descends as a dove on his head, but a voice speaks out of heaven and said, "This is my son in whom I'm well pleased." I'm not Jesus, but I sure hope that I'm profitable enough in my life as his servant that he'll say, "That's my son, and I'm pleased with him." I have a song that I sing every time I get a chance. It's just something rose out of me that just says, "In my life, Lord, be glorified. In my life, Lord, be glorified." Because you see, anything else really doesn't matter. When it's all said and done, you can have dollars in the bank, you can have fine cars and beautiful homes. And I'm not against any of it. I hope one day before I die, I own a Bentley convertible. That's my flesh that wants that. It has nothing to do with God. And God will say, "Okay, he's going to do it one way or another. I might as well help him." But you see, that's not going to heaven with me. None of those things will go to heaven with me. God loves the fact that I love his world that he's created. He loves every bit of that, but I can't take any of that with me. I may be able to come back here someday to some of it, but anything materialistically that I have will be gone by then. It'll be decayed, worn out, and gone. But you see, the most important thing of all is the eternal. The things not seen. It's the lives that we change, the lives that we touch, the lives that we help, the lives we make an impact on. Sometimes we don't even know it when we're doing it. But you see, God takes our inefficiencies and makes them efficient. He takes our insufficiencies and he makes us sufficient. And many times when we are doing what we're doing, we don't even know we're doing it at the time. But God is causing us to be profitable. Why? I'm hooked to him. Don't get unhooked from God. Stay hooked to him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father. I pray, God, that some way through my tears and my emotion today, that someone is impacted and someone is touched to know that that's what this is all about. It's about the eternal weight of glory, the eternal reward, the eternal blessing. And what we do, God, is preparing for eternity to become the profitable servant that you want us to be. Help us, God, to to be profitable today in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
For more information about Victory Church or to browse our media library, find us online at www.victorychurchnwa.com. Thanks be to God who always leads us in victory.